Hey guys, it's Wolf and Storm, aka Lisa, coming at you with another live video. This one, as you can see by the thumbnail, is, as promised, my first review for my first bit of Time Lord Victorious merchandise, Titan Comics number one, for their Time Lord Victorious storyline. Apart from that, we have a little bit of spoilerage concerning Time Lord Victorious and some mighty hefty changes they're making to Doctor Who canon, specifically the Time War. There's an article that is referencing that we're going to talk about. And then thirdly, we have another Doctor Who article talking about Jodie and I guess how her portrayal of the Doctor explains everything. You'll see. Anyway, before we move forward at all, just want to say that I'm sorry I was a little quiet this week, or last week online. I was out of town. So I did do a video last week. It might not have been as polished as I would like, but, you know, I was out of town, so I had to do the best with what I had available. But now I am back and back in business. So, a little bit of housekeeping as usual. If you enjoy this content and want to see some more, help me keep on keeping on. Social media links are in the description below for my Twitter and Patreon. If you are watching me now, you obviously know where to find me on YouTube. And if you are here, don't forget, hit that like and subscribe on that button right there. Smash that bell so you can keep abreast of what's on this channel forever and always. Anyway, on to the show. Almost. Time Lord Victorious. Let's see what it looks like, shall we? Isn't that pretty? Well, it's not anything different than what we've already seen. This is only one of the covers, though. I actually have this on physical order from Forbidden Planet, but I haven't received it yet. One, because they obviously got a lot of orders, so they're still waiting for their distributor to give them their copies. And two, because it's in the UK, so it's going to take a little while. But fortunately, if you are unable to get a physical copy from Forbidden Planet, there is another way, folks. You can go to comixology.com. They are a subsidiary of Amazon, and you will be able, for a small fee, be able to purchase this comic in digital download format. So you don't have to wait for a physical copy. I went and did that anyway, because I didn't want to have to wait 50 gazillion years for my hard copy to get it, because, you know, I love you guys and I want to give you this content, and I can't give you the content unless I read the comic. So this is only one cover, but there's four additional covers and one specialty cover. I love Doctor Who, but I am limited in my funds, so I could not buy every single cover, so I just chose the one that looked most impressive to me. And the other four covers are like actual comic drawing type covers. This one is just the Time Lord Victorious cover. I wanted this one because it was the one that I think is the best cover. I'm not particularly keen on the artist's drawing rendition of 10 in this comic, so I didn't want to bother myself with the actual comic book covers. And the Dalek specialty cover, you know, I'll stick with the Time Lord Victorious cover. Anyway, when I originally opened this up to read it, I realized that it is a follow-up, actually, from some events that had taken place earlier. And I'm thinking to myself, how am I going to understand the story if I don't know what the hell he did before? If you look at the second page, there's a description of the 10th Doctor, which you really don't need, because, I mean, come on, it's the 10th Doctor. Everybody knows who the 10th Doctor is. And there's a description of the 13th Doctor, which, do we really care? But she's there. Apparently because whatever happens in the Time Lord Victorious storyline, it's a direct result of something that happened between the 13th and the 10th Doctors when they met up. So, in order to understand this, I was thinking, do I want to read a 13th Doctor comic? Do I want to go that far to really have an understanding of this? But I figured if I'm really going to grasp the overall storyline, I'm really going to have to dig. Fortunately, I know there are sites out there where you don't, where you can find comic books uploaded, and you don't have to fork over the cash. So I did find one, and I was able to read all four issues of the 13th Doctor / 10th Doctor meetup, where they take on a confluence of Weeping Angels and Autons in 1969 London. This is basically, they're taking the episode Blink, where the part of the episode where the Doctor and Martha are stuck in 1969 waiting for Billy, the cop, to show up to help them out to get back to the TARDIS. In that like month or so that they're stuck there waiting, the 13th Doctor shows up quite by accident, because she was actually attempting to take her fam to Woodstock. And of course, you know how the TARDIS is. The TARDIS takes him to London in 1969, and she didn't know why. So, but she does remember being there, obviously. So she's like, oh shit, we can't meet up, because that's not good. It's a paradox. Although, you know something, this is not the first time that Doctors have met up before, and it's never really caused a universe-bending paradox. So kind of like, because, you know, we have the three Doctors, and the five Doctors, and the two Doctors, Doctor and Metacrisis Doctor, you know, so we have the Day of the Doctor with the three Doctors, so, you know, it doesn't really cause a paradox of biblical proportions. For some reason, this particular meetup causes issues. I don't know. All right, so before we go any further, if you have not read Time Lord Returns number 1 or the 13th Doctor / 10th Doctor meetup, those four issues, I would suggest, if you don't care, keep listening, because as you all know very well by now, this is not a spoiler-free blog, so you are going to get all the deets. If you don't want those deets, go ahead and press pause, wait till you check it out, come back later. Anyway, moving forward. So in that comic book, I'm not going to go into the story because it's really not important. All you need to know is they took on the Weeping Angels and the Autons. They dealt with them. Obviously, we know that they dealt with them because Martha and the Doctor met up with Billy eventually and went back to their present day. And the 13th Doctor went on with the Fam to do her thing. So, but whatever, for some reason, because they had met up, I don't know why, it's never really explained. Maybe it will be explained later on within the Time Lord Victorious ethos. It caused some sort of weird paradox. But a paradox so massive that it is apparently written out the Time War. Or at least blanked it from everybody's memory so nobody remembers that it ever happened. Except for the Doctor himself. Although I think in the next 13th Doctor issues, at least on her side, she's going to have her own paradox to deal with, because when she goes to take the fam home to Sheffield, London looks like a war zone. And I think that's supposed to lead into the newest Doctor, 13th Doctor, 10th Doctor comic, where they meet up with Rose. Although I'm starting to get the impression this might be an alternate universe Rose. Not the Rose we know that's in the parallel world with the Metacrisis Doctor, but like a alternate timeline Rose, specifically because of the event that they caused, which would be really, really, really fucked up. You know something? I don't like reading 13th Doctor comics because I don't like the 13th Doctor, but because Rose is in it, oh, you got me. You got me. And because the 10th Doctor's in it, so I'm going to have to see how this plays out, because I have a distinct feeling that it's not the Rose he knows. That it's because of whatever paradox that they made happen, that this is some alternate timeline Rose. Not alternate universe, but alternate timeline. Because what she's wearing doesn't quite match what he remembers seeing her. Remember when she when he meets up with her in Journey's End, she's wearing the blue leather jacket, but she's got a pink shirt on. In the cover of the comic, the new one that's set to come out in a couple of months, she's wearing the same blue leather jacket, but she's got a green shirt on. And I didn't notice that at first, but then I remembered and I started thinking to myself, this might be like an alternate timeline Rose. Like maybe a version of her that never met him or whatever. And because they said that she's a leader of the human resistance, and she while she was a defender of the Earth on the in the parallel universe, she wasn't a leader of a human resistance there, because they weren't resisting against anything. So I just have this distinct impression it's kind of like a Terminator thing, where you did something, you fucked up somewhere in time, and, you know, it reverberated on and changed the whole timeline. So I guess they're going to have to figure it out and set things right. But you know that's going to be super hard for him, because it's Rose. It's Rose. You know, how hard is that going to be for him to let her go again? Even though I'm fairly, like, 99% certain that in this comic book, this version of Rose doesn't know him. Will not know him. Because the Time War apparently never happened. So if the Time War never happened, the Time War is such a huge event in his life that for it to never have happened and never have caused him to regenerate, and then later on in his life happened to show up at Hendrick's department store to meet her that night, you know, the Time War is directly responsible for him meeting her in a very specific way. So if he created such a huge paradox that the Time War never happened, he likely would not have ever met her. Why it's not affecting him specifically, I don't know. Maybe it's because it's concerned around him and the 13th Doctor. I'm not really sure, but I know it's going to be an interesting comic book because it's not for anything having to do with the 13th Doctor, but more for their relationship. For all I know, it might even give at least him some closure to be able to say, if he knows that she's not his Rose, not the Rose that knows him, but at least a Rose that he can talk to and unburden himself with, because at the end of the day, when they fix it, she's going to disappear from the timeline anyway, because she's in a timeline that isn't really supposed to exist. Maybe he can say the things to her that he couldn't say to the real Rose, because he knows at the end of the day it's not going to matter. He'll at least be able to get those things off his chest. Yeah, you never know. I think it's something he desperately needs. You know, because at this point, there's a lot of things he wanted to tell her that he couldn't tell her. And I'm still not sure where exactly in his timeline he is here. I know that in the Time Lord Victorious, it's supposedly he's traveling with Martha at this time. But I remember in the marketing for this, they said that it was around the time, somewhere around Waters of Mars, when he was alone. So why they're tying this to that other comic with the 13th Doctor that definitely takes place in season or series 3 for the 10th Doctor. Confused. I would really love to know what time frame he's in, because he says he's not traveling with anyone, or at least he doesn't think he is. He's not sure. So back to the comic itself. The comic is written by Jody Hauser, and the illustrator and colorist are all women, which is not a bad thing. Honestly, I'm not so into comics that I really care whether it's written by women or men. I mostly only care about that if you're going to draw the comics, you draw it properly. And that was really the only issue that I had with the comic. I didn't have an issue with the story. I think the overall concept is really strong. It's just the execution's kind of wibbly-wobbly. The artistry in the comic does definitely leave a little bit to be desired. So where this comic starts off is Ten is unconscious, and he comes to in the console room, and he's not sure how he got there, and he doesn't remember anything. Of course he remembers who he is, but he doesn't remember how he became unconscious, and apparently he doesn't remember the fact that he was supposedly traveling with someone, but he's not entirely sure. He's not sure where he is, so when he goes outside to check, ta-da, he's surrounded by a bunch of Daleks. And when he confronts them, well, first, he's like, what do you want? And they say that they need his help. And he's like, yeah, no. And he disappears, and they proceed to chase him wherever he's, you know, throughout space and time. And I'm kind of looking like, last I checked, Daleks were not that good at following the Doctor, especially in the TARDIS. TARDIS is a very hard ship to pin down, so the artist, the storyboardist is already taking liberties with the Dalek's abilities. But anyway, you'll notice in this comic that the designs for the Daleks are more reminiscent of season 11 and season 5 onward, like Doctor 11 and 12. Daleks, they're definitely not Russell T. Davies era Daleks, which I'm kind of about, because I've always felt like the Russell T. Davies era Daleks in their bronze casings were much scarier, more of a threat, especially the ones that were kind of war-beaten and messed up, and I always felt that those were more of a threat. The newer, more colorful ones, I kind of like, I always had a hard time taking them seriously, to be honest with you. I know that those were, like, made to be reminiscent of the classic Daleks from the classic series, but for some reason, in the classic series, I was able to take them more seriously looking like that than I was able to take them seriously in New Who looking the same way. I don't know why, it's just, maybe, it's probably more to do with the level of writing, honestly. But the point is, he's like, I'm not going to help you. You got to be kidding me. And when he explains to them about the Time War, he's like, why would I help you? You're my mortal enemy. Remember that little thing called the Time War? And they're like, we have no record of the Time Lords in our databanks. And he's of the Time War in our databanks. And he's looking at them like, I'm sorry, excuse me, what? Because, you know, how can you not remember the war that destroyed your own people? So right there, he knows something's wrong. He can't figure out what. So apparently, according to them, even though he is their mortal enemy and the thing they fear the most, there is something out there that they fear more than him. And they need his help. So he's struggling to understand why. And when he finally gets them to explain, they tell him that whatever this creature is called the Hond. It is so destructive that it wants to destroy everything, like reality itself. They say in comparison to them, the Daleks just want to destroy everything that's not Dalek. They don't want to destroy themselves. The Hond wants to destroy everything. Doesn't matter what it is. And then I look at them, I'm like, hold up. Did y'all just forget about the reality bomb that was your own creator created? That was literally going to destroy the entirety of existence. This has got to take place before Stolen Earth and Journey's End. Because if it didn't, if they would know. They would know if this took place after. So I'm thinking this takes place earlier in his timeline. Although if so, why would you mention Waters of Mars? That just, the marketing for this whole series is just, anyway, so he's immediately curious that there is any sort of creature in the known universe that could strike fear in the Daleks, specifically for the fact that the Daleks do not understand the concept of fear or the concept of human emotion whatsoever, because it's bred out of them. So for them to be able to be afraid of anything is just insane. So, you know, being the Doctor, he can't turn away from that, because, you know, just the curiosity of wanting to understand what kind of creature could possibly make them afraid. So they take him with them and the TARDIS on their ship, and they go back to Skaro. Apparently Skaro still exists. Yeah, see, no Time Wars. Daleks, Skaro still exists. Makes you wonder, is Davros there? So they get there and they hand him off to the Dalek lead strategist, who is supposed to be a war-torn, battle-torn Dalek, like one of the oldest Daleks in existence. Although the way that he's drawn and colored in the comics does not suggest that. He's a little bit rusty, but he's described as having like holes in him from all the beatings he's taken and all the wars and battles he's been in. It's really not apparent in the drawing on the page. The other thing that I have some issues with the comic is that it seems like They don't know how to emote 10 very well. When I read the four issues with 13th Doctor and 10th Doctor, remember, the colorist, illustrator, and writer for this Time Lord Victorious comic also did those four comics. They emoted the women really well, but not the men. And whenever he would say, like, allons-y, or what? You know, like, you know how, what his facial expressions are. David Tennant was very emotive in the face. But in the comic, and sometimes his words would not match his facial expressions. Like when he was doing the, what? You expect his face to be like, what? And in the frame, the picture did not match. I don't know if it was an oversight or they just didn't have the visual reference to go off of. It wouldn't have been hard. I mean, there are so much video and pictures of David Tennant out there. It's ridiculous. And there's tons of GIFs of him going, what? So, I mean, it's not like they didn't have the ability to get the reference. Anyway, and also the color tones, the backgrounds. I'm not too keen on the purples and pinks and blues. It's too bright, especially on Skaro. I'm glad that they were able to get the visual reference system to make sure that Skaro was drawn correctly, but the atmosphere was very bright. And that's not how Skaro is, especially now after, you know, after the Khalids are all dead and the Daleks took over. So, I don't know, maybe it's just, I don't want to say that it's a result of females drawing this, because I don't like to get into the differences between male-drawn comics and female-drawn comics, but there's a definite energy about these comics that is very feminine. That just doesn't seem right. It doesn't seem to go with the gravity of the story. I would have thought it'd be much darker, especially on Skaro. Also, in the panels that they did for the console room, they kept flip-flopping where the computer screen was on whichever side of the console. Stop! The TARDIS, the console screen that he types in and whatever and does his scanning is on the side of the console right next to the jump seat. Everybody knows that. It seemed like in every other panel it would switch sides. And I don't know if it was because they were drawing it from a different perspective or what, but even if the drawing was flipped from a different perspective, you still should have seen the jump seat behind him. Was not there. So I don't know, again, if that's an oversight or if they were just didn't have the visual reference or what. I really hate to think that whoever's drawing the comics did not watch enough of the show to get the visual references, or at least didn't do enough of the research to get the visual references. Because I'm telling you, when I read the 13th Doctor / 10th Doctor comic, the visual references for her TARDIS was a gazillion times better, even though I don't particularly care for her console room. Okay, let's be honest. But it was much more accurate than 10's. I feel like that's not very fair. Just because it's a different doctor doesn't mean he doesn't deserve to have an accurate looking console room. Anyway, so he's on Skaro and the lead strategist has been assigned to take him into the building where they keep all their most dangerous weapons. The weapons he knows they have that they used during the Time War. Apparently have gone unused thus far because the Time War has not happened. So they go in, and of course they come across a bunch of booby traps that they have to maneuver around. And while they're in there, he's, of course, gobbling up a storm, and the Dalek is just like, you know, just letting him talk. And he's just trying to make small talk and get to know this Dalek better. He figures, if I'm going to be stuck with this thing, at least, you know, try to make conversation. But of course, Dalek is a Dalek and is not going to want to talk to you. It does its best to answer his questions, and then the whole building shakes, and almost comes down around them. And at the end of that first comic, the Hand creature appears, and it looks like Clayface from the animated, the Batman animated series. And when you consider all of the creatures in the universe that the Daleks have destroyed, all the alien races, the fact that they managed to destroy the Time Lords, the most powerful race in the universe. This Hand creature that they have such an issue with. And I'll make, and here's the reference right there. That doesn't seem like much of a threat. One good blast from a Dalek's gun, you'd think would take it down, right? Is that the only Hand? Is there more? Is there an army? A fleet? I don't know. It just doesn't seem viable enough to be something that the Daleks, the entire Dalek race, would fear. I don't know. I guess we'll have to wait till we see more of the comics. I know that the second one is supposed to be out, I think, next month. So we will get a look at that one eventually. And we'll get more of the story, I guess. Again, if you guys want the full details on the Time Lord Victoria's timeline, I will put the link in the description that you guys can go to. The website sponsored by DoctorWho.com that has the whole picture laid out. It's like a timeline. It's a timeline that explains what comes out when. The only things that on that timeline that cannot be certain of at this point is the live experiences, for obvious reasons. I know there's supposed to be that live experience in 2021, which may still happen on time. Don't know. I do know for a fact, though, that all of this Time Lord Victoria's storyline is supposed to be done by January. So if they want to get it all done the way they want to do it, then Time Fracture, that live escape room theater thing, is going to have to be latest January. Everything else is comics, audios, and books. So, again, I will put the link in the description if you want to get a look at that. And also put links in the description for Comixology if you guys want to get a digital copy of this instead of having to wait for Forbidden Planet. I know it's difficult for those of us in the U.S. who don't have the direct access like they do in the U.K. So we'll definitely put the Comixology link in the description if you want to download your own copy. I am not going to put a link in the description to take you where I saw, where I was able to read the 13th Doctor / 10th Doctor meetup comic, because a little shiny. So, but I'm sure if you guys are as good as I think you are with computers and the interwebs, you can find it yourself if you really want to waste your time with that. But it's really not necessary to read the whole thing, because I mean the whole story is kind of self-contained and really has nothing to do with the Time Lord Victorious. I just wanted to understand where this paradox thing was coming from. Really, just because they met up. I mean, they didn't do anything to cause an issue. They defeated the Weeping Angels and the Autumn, so. But they didn't stick around each other for longer than was necessary. Not any longer than he's ever stuck around any other time he's met up with past or future versions of himself. So, I don't know. Anyway. So, next. Moving on. All right, now we're going to get into the articles, my friends. This is Screen Rant. Doctor Who's Time War has just been erased from history. This article specifically has to do with what Time Lord Victoria's storyline has done surrounding the Time War. And right now, I am really upset because the Time War is a huge piece of Doctor Who lore that should not be messed with, because it has serious ramifications for everything, like the entirety of the New Who universe. I mean, Russell literally based his New Who story on this concept. So to take it away, you might as well just New Who gone. This is written by Thomas Bacon. He's a frequent Screen Rant writer. The Time War is one of the most important events in the history of Doctor Who, and it's just been completely erased from the timeline. Well, fuck. Doctor Who's Time War has just been erased from history. When Russell T. Davies relaunched Doctor Who in 2005, he introduced the idea of the Time War, a vast, sprawling conflict between the Time Lords and the Daleks that ended in mutual destruction. It was an inspired idea. Oh, you bet it was. Because the addition of this new part of Doctor Who lore meant old school and new fans were on the same page, fascinated by a brand new status quo. Yes, this is true. When he rebooted the series in 2005, the lore was so complicated because it had previously had 26, 27 years worth of history. So he had to decide when he was going to reboot this, do I keep the Time Lords there and all that crazy, all that craziness and all that lore, or do I just invent something to get rid of the Time Lords? Not that they were never there, just this big sprawling conflict so that I can start fresh where the Doctor has lost all his people and he's traveling alone. This way, most of the people that were going to start watching the show were not necessarily the hardcore fans. Yes, of course the hardcore fans were there, but the bigger audience was the casuals, the ones that had not watched for 26 years. A lot of them had grown up during the wilderness years from 1989 to 2005, where it wasn't on TV at all. So they didn't really have a frame of reference. And to have the Time Lords, to bring it back with the Time Lords already there would have been kind of confusing, because then they would have to go back and research and want to try to understand what all this crap means. So getting rid of the Time Lords by having this big huge war wipe them out was actually the best idea he could have ever had. Because not only did it make it easier for new fans coming in, but it also established a totally new characterization of the Doctor as a person. It started him off on a completely different foot than any other Doctor that had come before. It was a perfect platform for Christopher Eccleston. This is the exact kind of acting juice that he is known for and is stellar at, to play this battle-worn, bitter, PTSD-ridden, lost, lonely, broken, horribly broken, self-loathing, lonely man who has lost everything and is basically not living, just surviving day to day, until just one night, out of the blue, he happens to meet Rose Tyler. And that whole conflict, that loss, shapes him as a character going forward from 9 to 10, 11 and 12. Without the Time War, he would never have made the decisions that he made or did the things that he did. So he might never have met Rose. He would never have given his life to save her after she gave her life to save him, regenerating into 10 because he loved her. He would never have done the things he did as 10, or gone through the immense character development, the furious highs and the lowest of the lows as 10. All of these things would not have happened to him without the Time War as that, you know, constant source of guilt in the background. We seriously wouldn't have the 50th anniversary special, Day of the Doctor, either. I mean, the whole special was built around it. So for them to just snip it out, that's like, come on now. Even more intriguing, the Doctor carried the weight of the Time War upon his shoulders because he was the one who ended it, destroying both Gallifrey and the Daleks. Yes, this was something that haunted him and haunts him still. So it was a totally new characterization for him. It was a direction that the show had never gone in before, ever. And it gave each actor that played the Doctor in the New Who era such amazing juice to work with. Such depth and such emotion to play with. So to take all that away, not only does it kind of shit on all the actors and all the hard work that they did and the writers and all the hard work that they did, and especially Russell for building this world. I mean, it pretty much rips New Who apart. The truth was eventually revealed in the 50th anniversary special, The Day of the Doctor, in which viewers learned that the Doctor had not destroyed Gallifrey after all. Rather, the Time War had ended with Gallifrey being transported into a sort of pocket dimension, perfectly preserved. The Dalek fleet had been destroyed in the ensuing flare of energy, and pretty much they shot each other. It was a tremendous twist, bringing the shadow of Gallifrey back into play once again and redeeming the Doctor, meaning he was no longer the one who destroyed his own people. Now, though, it seems that all that lore has been erased because the Time War has been wiped from his... Exactly what I just said. It means it's like the 50th anniversary special would never have happened. Now, look, y'all know that I have my issues with the 50th and how they kind of just said, oh, that's okay. He never actually destroyed it. Screw all the brokenness and the PTSD and character development. He can just go back into his own timeline and fix it, even though he's expressly told his companions in the past that was a big no-no, the number one no-no. But I digress. The bigger problem is this is almost akin to what they did with timeless children in some ways. Getting rid of the Time War completely decimates New Who, whereas Timeless Child just decimates the show entirely. Because everything in New Who is predicated on this concept. Without it, it would have been a completely different show from the beginning. So I would really rather believe that this is like an alternate timeline or something. You can see here, these are some of the pages. This is when the 10th Doctor initially meets up with the Dalek at first. And he says, we have no record of a time war. The Doctor will come with us. Not in your records? What? You're scared? Aren't you a frightened Dalek? Now there's something you don't see every day. You know, that alone is enough to freak him out a little bit because, like I said, Daleks have no concept of fear, or really no concept of human emotion as a whole. So for them to be afraid, that's like, eh. This week's Doctor Who Time Lord Victorious number one is the beginning of a massive transmedia event kicking off with David Tennant's 10th Doctor recruited by the Daleks as their last defense. The unlikely scenario is made all the more disturbing when the Doctor realizes history has changed dramatically. While the Daleks are aware of Gallifrey's existence, they have absolutely no recollection of the Time War. Needless to say, the discovery leaves the Doctor shaken. And see, it would explain why he doesn't have a companion with him. If this is, in fact, during the period of time where he's traveling with Martha, if the Time War never happened, he would never have met Rose. And then he would never have met Martha. So there would be no reason for her to be there. Really, there he should still be in his ninth self. Or maybe even not even ninth self. He might not even have regenerated into the War Doctor. He could still be his eighth self. So seriously weird shit is going on. That doesn't make sense. The Doctor is a time sensitive, and he could already sense he was dealing with a paradox of some kind, but the scale of this change in time is beyond belief, not least because the history of both Daleks and the Time Lords was sealed by a time lock, just as you might cauterize a wound to stop it bleeding. Yes, we all know that when the Doctor used the moment to end the war, he sealed the Time War in a time lock so that it would not bleed over into the rest of the universe. If he hadn't done it, the universe would have burned. The Time War came close to breaking the entire time-space continuum, and meddling with it, let alone wiping it from the timeline, is to risk all creation. Yes, everything would change. You forget the Time War destroyed not just races and planets, but whole galaxies. We're talking about races that were using time as a weapon. People would die, and then they would be resurrected, and then they would die again, over and over and over, to keep fighting. And they would have those memories of their deaths and not understand why, and it would drive them to the brink of insanity, over and over, reliving that same death and not understanding why. The Doctor himself, when he was in the Time War, it is well known that he was 1,200 years old when he was the War Doctor. 1,300 years old. And as a result of the war, he was de-aged 400 years, which is why when we meet up with the Ninth Doctor at the beginning of Series 1, he tells Rose he's 900 years old, when actually he should be older. But the results of the Time War were catastrophic. They literally used time as a weapon. They destroyed whole galaxies, whole civilizations, wiped out. So for the Time War to never have happened, it would change literally the face of the universe. That's why I can't imagine they would do something that catastrophic. It's reasonable to assume the change is even bigger, though. The Doctor learns the Daleks are facing a threat from the Dark Times, an era when the Time Lords were far more interventionist and wiped out races like the Retcons and the Great Vampires. And this is the beginning of the Time Lord Victoria's arc, which promises to send the Doctor back to those Dark Times, meaning it's entirely possible he is the one who's created this new timeline. That would certainly be the biggest paradox in the history of Doctor Who. Yeah, I don't even know what to think at this point. So, it's possible that this paradox happened as a result of something he's going to do? So, obviously they've got to fix this, because this can't stand. Like, the Time War has to happen. It's a fixed point. Can't fuck with fixed points. Even he knows this. So I have to assume that once this is all said and done and over, that it's going to be like a rubber band expanding and popping back, and this will be fixed. Things will go back to the way they're supposed to be. They have to, because this can't stand. It is too. Like, I know they're trying to. I know the BBC is trying to make money because their 13th Doctor merchandise is not selling and their ratings are in the shitter. So they have to make money somehow. And since they can't really advertise the upcoming season because they don't know when the upcoming season is going to even occur, it's sad. They haven't even advertised for the Festive Special. They're doing more advertising The Time Lord Victorious than they are for their own Festive Special that's supposed to be New Year's. So I guess it's because they know what makes money and what doesn't. And I'm sorry for all those out there that were hoping this Time Lord Victorious would involve the 13th Doctor, but the Time Lord Victorious is specifically a Russell T. Davies era construct that specifically involves the 10th Doctor. I mean, the words came out of his mouth. It has to do with him and having his god complex. So it makes more sense that it's revolved around him. Not only that, but, you know, if you like the 13th Doctor and Chibnall era, more power to you. You know, I ain't gonna argue with you. But that doesn't mean that the rest of us have to like it too. You got to understand reality. The reality is that her stuff does not sell. It might sell a little, but not enough for them to make a profit. And they know that if you slap David Tennant's face on something with a Doctor Who title, that shit gonna sell. I mean, look at what happened when Big Finish just came out with their Out of Time Part 1, their team up between the 10th and the 4th Doctors. That shit through the roof. Big time. And not just because of David Tennant's face, but because of Tom as well. So, you know, they have to go with what they know is going to make them money. And unfortunately, it's not her. Well, I am just going to hope that this doesn't turn out like I think it's going to turn out, because I cannot imagine them retconning the Time War from lore. It's too intrinsic to New Who. I mean, if they get rid of it and they say that this is canon, then you might as well just stop New Who entirely. Because nothing that's happened with them will make any sense anymore. Pretty much a retcon the entire show from 2005 on. That's fucked up. Really fucked up. But hey, no more fucked up than what they've already done, right? Speaking of that, going into the next article, this is from Bleeding Cool. This has to do with Jodie and the 13th Doctor. Doctor Who, here's why the 13th Doctor's origin explains everything. I can't tell if this article is trying to bolster her and be positive, or if it's trying to shit on her. Hard to tell. Written by Adi Tantameda. The 13th Doctor, played by Jodie Whittaker and helmed by showrunner Chris Chibnall, is the game changer for Doctor Who in many ways. First, she was the first female lead in canon. Then, in her second season, Chibnall dropped a bombshell. The Doctor was the original timeless child, an immortal being from an unknown place who became the basis for all the Time Lords. Not discussing this anymore. I've given too much energy to this topic. No more. The child came to the universe through a gateway from another universe or dimension. Her adopted mother, Tech Dayan, discovered her regenerative ability to turn into another body, and even gender if she suffered a fatal injury. Tech Dayan experimented on the child to understand regeneration, then gave it to herself and the elite of Gallifreyan society. Now immortal, the Gallifreyans developed time travel technology and built up the planet with the new Time Lords ruling elite. Every Time Lord had some of the Doctor's DNA in them. Without the Doctor, there would be no Time Lords. Chibnall said the Doctor is non-binary a year before this retcon. He was planning this from the start of his run. Yeah, no shit. We all know that Chibnall specifically stated to the BBC that he would not take on the title of showrunner of Doctor Who unless he was allowed to cast a woman in the role of the Doctor. That was, like, in the contract. And again, I don't give a shit that she's a woman. I give a shit that she's badly written and badly acted. The retcon that changed everything. This is one of those "everything you thought you knew was wrong" retcons that writers introduce to spice up a series that threatens to get long in the tooth. I'll admit that as the Moffat years wore on, the writing was getting a bit long in the tooth. That doesn't necessarily mean that you had to do a major, like, axis tilt to make people watch. If you improve the writing, bring a new showrunner in, improve the writing, maybe have given Peter Capaldi a few more years, because he was at least planning on staying for, at a minimum, 5 years. Got totally screwed. If you've just given him better scripts to work with, let Moffat go. Because it was obvious he was getting burned out. Let him go, bring a new showrunner in that knew what he was doing, like Mark Gatiss, or, you know, just somebody that knows what they're doing. You wouldn't have to do this. You didn't have to do it at all. This wasn't about, oh, we're trying to spice things up and bring new people. No, this was, I don't like this show anymore. Doctor Who fucking sucks. And I'm going to do it my way just to piss everybody off. That's what this was. Alan Moore's deconstructionist approach casts, of course, it came out of comics. Alan Moore's deconstructionist approach casts a long shadow over this approach, as the current showrunners were all influenced by his work. Russell T. Davies did it by having Gallifrey destroyed and making the Doctor the one who did it to stop the Time War. Yeah, but that wasn't retconning prior storyline. It was adding to. It wasn't saying that the Time Wars didn't exist or that how they came to be was different. It was something he added to. It created a whole new dimension to their ethos and made the Doctor such a much more rounded and deeper person. Then Davies brought Gallifrey back at the end of his tenure. I think you're talking about End of Time Part 2. That was for like all of 10 seconds before the Doctor averted it and sent it packing. Stephen Moffat did it by changing history so the Doctor didn't destroy Gallifrey at all, but preserved it. Yeah, I didn't quite like that. It was like, just let well enough alone. But I did like what happened in Heaven Sent and how hard he worked to get there. Now Chris Chibnall takes it further by not only destroying Gallifrey again, and now revealing the truth behind the Doctor's origin and the nature of regeneration and the Time Lord lore. Used to be when we would get an episode that would mention Gallifrey or give us a Gallifrey clip or a montage, it was all, or have the Doctor talking about it, was always, ooh, ah, oh, that's so sad, and it would inspire such emotion in you just to see it, just for even a second. Just to hear the word Gallifrey come out of his mouth, it was such a big deal. So every time you would see it on screen, it was like, oh. And then, after how hard he worked to bring it back, the long way around, she walks through the portal, which I don't even believe was previously there. It's this magical fucking portal that appears out of nowhere to a decimated Gallifrey. It's no longer, oh, it's more like, again? You've already destroyed a planet and a civilization once. You can't do it twice and expect to have the same reaction. It's just not going to work. It didn't work. It just pissed everybody off. Because of everything the Doctor had been through to change history, to bring it back. Everything he had gone through in the past, believing he had destroyed his own people and how much that affected him and how much it destroyed him. Now this? Are you... Really? The Doctor was an abused child. Chibnall's changed history also answers some fundamental questions that have lingered over the show's entire history. He turned the Doctor into an abused child at heart, and Gallifrey her abuser. It explains why the Doctor may save Gallifrey time and again, but never wants to stay. The Doctor always gets to hell away once the good deed is done. Chibnall doesn't spell it out, but that's because the Doctor can't bear to stay at the place where they abused her for thousands, possibly millions of years. They may have wiped her memories, but deep down the Doctor remembers. The question of why the Doctor ran away is answered at last. Even after the Doctor gets elected president, he never stayed to enjoy the power and prestige because he knew it was founded on lies, hypocrisy, and her exploitation. He didn't. If his mind was wiped, that would mean we have no fucking clue. When the 13th Doctor was told she was the tiniest child, she was like, huh? What the fuck are you talking? So how is she... How would she know? There was no memories for her to draw on, him to draw on, to not want to stay on Gallifrey. The reason why he left Gallifrey was because he didn't agree with their politics. He didn't like the way that they did things. It wasn't because he hated them. They were still his people, and whenever they needed him, he would always go back to help. But he didn't, he felt stifled. He didn't want to be controlled. He wanted to go out and be his own person and do his own thing. He didn't want to submit to rules. That's the way he always was. He was a rule breaker. He was a renegade. He was someone who would want to be his own person and do his own thing. It didn't have anything to do with abuse. But the fact that Chibnall has brought child abuse into this is even more sick. He's turned what was previously a quite noble race that, yes, I know, had their issues because of the war. And even the Sixth Doctor admitted that they had become stagnant and corrupt. Yes. But we're talking about a race that had been around for billions of years, who had become so old and ancient within themselves that they can't even remember their own history. Which... seems to me like an oxymoron, because they're the arbiters of time, so you would think if anybody would know their own history, it would be them. So to turn this, these austere peoples, who, yes, I know, were not infallible, and yes, they had problems, they had their issues, but to turn them into this, I don't even know what to say. Like, that's just sad. Do you really hate the Time Lords that much? Honestly, that much? Or maybe it's just the male ones that you hate. I don't know. But I don't believe that's why he left. He left because that wasn't his way. He offered himself as a candidate to become president in the Deadly Assassin, but that was because he had a plan. He was trying to stop the Master from doing what he was doing. He never did anything without an explicit plan. It was never his intent to actually be president. He just did what he had to do to make the plan happen. It's the same thing in Invasion of Time. He went there claiming his right to be the president, but it wasn't because he wanted to be, it was because he had a plan to stop an invasion. So, you know, the Doctor never did anything without reason. He might not have cared for their rules, but he did have friends there. He did have people on Gallifrey that he cared a great deal about. He had a family. And if he had hated them as much as you're saying, because of abuse, he wouldn't have felt such loss, such pain when he had to do what he had to do in the Time War. So, yeah, that's so contradictory and makes very little sense. Seeing Doctor Who in a new light. The Doctor's abuse at the hands of Gallifrey also explains why the Doctor became a protector of children. It's not just the right and kind thing to do. It comes from a place of trauma and deep empathy. Granted, in a show for children, the hero doesn't really need a reason to be a friend and protector of children. Now Chibnall has given the Doctor an emotional reason for doing it. To watch the old episodes of the show before Chibnall's retcon actually gives them an additional layer of meaning now. It doesn't diminish the past stories at all. When you watch past versions played by William Hartnell, Patrick Troughton, John Pertwee, Tom Baker, Peter Davison, Colin Baker, Paul McGann, and Sylvester McCoy, and their deeply ambivalent interactions with Gallifrey takes on new meaning. And knowing their origin as the time was child, Chibnall has also introduced more unknown incarnations out there prior to the First Doctor that opens up more story possibilities, not less. Chibnall has made our hero the underdog again and more mysterious than ever. With unlimited regenerations, the show can also now go on forever with no end. Okay. Certain incarnations of the Doctor are good with kids. Others, I wouldn't trust him with kids as far as I could throw. Namely the Sixth. Hello? And probably even the First. I mean, I know what you're going to say. When he traveled with his granddaughter, but she was already like high school age. She was older. We're talking about little children. And no, this show is not just for little children. This show is it's supposed to be a family show, right? Which means it's for children and adults. So please stop saying that it's geared towards kids. That might be what it's written for now in Chibnall era, because the level of writing and crappy acting would attest to that point, that it seems like they're writing it for little bitties. But Russell T. Davies era, Moffat era, the themes were very philosophical, very dark. Definitely not kid stuff. More like age 12 up. I have seen him protect children, but that's not an aberrant thing for him. The Doctor is a protector of all, not just children. Children, adults, basically just people in general. So that's kind of ridiculous. He doesn't protect children because he was abused. He protects them because they're children. Same way that he would protect adults and aliens and anybody that needed protecting. It doesn't have anything to do with some deep intrinsic need because of suffering some ridiculous abuse. Also, more mysterious than ever? Yeah, no. You've pretty much answered every question about the doctor that you can possibly answer. Other than his name. Now we know that the doctor is just one in a long line of gazillions of doctors going back millions of years. Honestly? Honestly. The doctor was built on mystery. He's not supposed to, we're not supposed to know how many incarnations, how many, we're not supposed to know what his real name is. We're not supposed to know who his parents were, or how he was brought up, or how many incarnations, or if there's any incarnations before him, or whatever. We're not supposed to have the answers to those questions. The character lives and thrives on his own mystery. That's what keeps the show running. Because that's, you're always wanting more. There's nothing more to give now that you've pretty much said, oh, well, this is how the Doctor came to be. You did that in that massive exposition in The Timeless Child. Just let the Master explain it all in glowing terms for you, that he was this, you know, she was this, and had her memories wiped, and she's millions of years old, which honestly is fucking impossible. I'm sorry, but she can't predate Time Lord history. There's just no way. Are you going to just say now that Rassilon doesn't exist anymore? All of that just doesn't exist anymore. Because Rassilon and Omega and the Other definitely came before the Doctor. Just saying. You can't act like 57 years worth of lore never existed. That's not how it works. I suspect Chibnall has also embedded the endpoint for the Doctor's story here. If he chooses to do it, the Doctor's final story will probably end with her dying and going through a gate, only to end up in the distant past and regenerate into the original Timeless Child to be found by Tech Tayun. That's my guess. Of course, a new showrunner could always retcon this all out in a flash, and we'll be off on another path. Please, Jesus. Please. But that's the nature of Doctor Who. It's a show whose own continuity has always been fluid. Writer Paul Cornell once said that the universe retcons itself every time the Doctor gets in the TARDIS and dematerializes. No, it doesn't. Don't like this bit of canon? Don't worry, a new one will be along in a moment. No. No! No, the canon is not fluid. You're saying this because when the show started, he wasn't called a Time Lord. That's because the show was new, and they didn't have background yet. They were building it as they went along. So in that 26 years worth of history that they had, they put the building blocks in to create this world, this Time Lord world, and this character. Those were the building blocks. That was their world building. What you did with Timeless Child was pretty much take a sledgehammer to it and just wham! Just destroyed the building. Basically. It definitely has a canon. You forget, science fiction lives and dies on canon. Without it, it can't survive. It would be too confusing, especially for a show that has been on this long. It just cannot. It needs canon to make sense. Yes, I know that when showrunners come in and go, they do change tiny little things. Maybe they didn't like how this looked on the TARDIS, so they take this out, put this in. But that's not disrupting huge, massive amounts of canon. That's just tiny, like, aesthetics. Yes, I know some doctors do have certain skills and other doctors don't, but that's because their personalities are all different and they value certain things more than others. Like I said, the third doctor and the 13th doctor, I guess, value the Venusian Aikido more than the others. The 10th doctor was particularly adept at telepathy, like the 4th doctor was, more than the others. It all goes with their personalities. Their desires and their wants and what they think is, you know, and what they like and what they don't like. It doesn't mean that it just automatically disappears. They still have the skills. It's just some like to use them and others don't. I mean, come on, people. Come on. This is not that hard of a concept to visualize. And don't get me started on Paul Cornell. We're talking about a dude that went in and freaking took one of the best Doctor Who stories of the New Who era. Family of Blood and Human Nature, and fucked it up this year by writing writing a post episode little short showing the 13th Doctor taking Sister of Mine out of the mirror to save her because, oh, she felt that she paid her penance. She's a murderer. If you take her out, she's going to go across the universe killing people to survive, because that's what she has to do. Otherwise, she'll only live for another 30 days and then she'll die. You realize that when you let her go, she's going to keep killing, right? That was the whole pretense of the two-parter. Great going, Paul. But yeah, who the fuck cares about canon, right? All right, so those were the articles. Yeah, that's about it. Got a good review for Time Lord Victorious. We went into another article about Jodie. Again, I'm not shitting on anybody that is a fan of Jodie or the 13th Doctor or the Chibnall era. Like I said, if this is your cup of tea, you go ahead and drink it. More power to you. And believe me, if you want to come on our YouTube channels to chat about it, I encourage friendly discussion and friendly debate. I do not encourage getting crapped on or Twitter tirades of any sort. That is not allowed. It is not nice, and I will not tolerate it. Not just for me, but for my other online friends who typically have to deal with this stuff consistently. We have no problem with honest, full-throated debate, but to a point. Like, that's why we're not part of the Not My Doctor crowd, because even they've gotten toxic. We don't have a problem with a female doctor. We don't even have a problem with a doctor of color. Don't care. All we care about is, can you tell a good story? Can you direct an episode well? That's what matters. And is the actor that you've chosen the best one for the role? Whether that's a woman, man, white, black, Asian, whatever. As long as they are the best person for the role, good on ya. More power to you. All right. I was going to talk about the rumors that have been flying around that Jodie might not get a 13th series, or that the 13th might be her last. But the others have already discussed it. Gary at Nerdrotic, Noel on the TARDIS Zone. So I'm sure you've already heard it. It all has to be taken with a grain of salt at this point. I mean, however, the person that has been giving us these rumors is the same person that told us initially about the whole Timeless Children storyline, and that came true. So you never know. I know Jodie has said that she's staying. I personally will not believe anything from the actors. I would rather hear it from BBC. If they're going to change doctors, or if Chibnall's getting fired, it always comes from the BBC. I mean, a changeover to a new doctor is a big deal. So until I hear it from the horse's mouth. Right now, I think the BBC has got bigger fish to fry. They just got a new director general who's upending everything that they've been doing thus far, which is a good thing. This way things will be more equal, because the way that things have been going on over there now, it's fucking ridiculous. So hopefully he can make things better over there. Hopefully the state of the show will be better. If that means he has to get rid of Chris Chibnall and Jodie to do it, hey, you know, great. But so I think that's what they're kind of focused on at the moment. rather than worrying about whether or not Jody's gonna stay. So, you know as about as much as I do. All right, guys, I will be back at you. You can find me on Twitter as usual. Links will be in the description. Don't forget, I will be in the TARDIS zone this Sunday for our New Who Watch Along Season 2 Finale Doomsday. Don't forget the tissues! Don't forget the tissues! I simultaneously love and hate this episode. Anyway, you can catch me there. I'm going to try to be there for the Classic Who Watch Along as well on Saturday. Possibly catch me there as well. And then as soon as I get more information, as soon as I get the next piece of Time Lord Victoria's merchandise, we'll do another video. I know that there's also been some... Before this comic book came out, there was the 2021 Doctor Who Annual, which is like a year book of sorts that has some information tied into Time Lord Victorious. It's basically some little blurbs that River Song has written about the Dark Times. Don't need to buy that. I personally don't need to buy that because it's mostly about Jody and the 13th Doctor and everyone. Yeah, I'm not spending my money on that. And it's really just background about the vampires and the Hond and, like, you know, the Dark Times creatures. So it's really not that important, I think, to go along with the rest of the story. Not that intrinsic to buy. So October, I should be doing another video when we get Time Lord Victoria's number dos. And then we will go on from there, I guess. Again, all links will be in the description for comic books and social media. And also the Time Lord Victoria's timeline. So if you want to take a look at it, it'll be there. Don't forget, like and subscribe, guys. Help me keep on keeping on. Peace out.